First, I want to thank our exhibit sponsors for Wild Wonders of China. Sponsored by Anonymous, Thomas Gilchrist Foundation, Carol and Jim Linton, Scott Kirkpatrick, Lori and Laurent Roux, Deborah and Jonathan Hertel, Judith B. Moyle, and the Wyoming Arts Council. And I want to thank the sponsors of Mixed Media, who sponsor these Mixed Media programs throughout the year. Silver Star Communications, Heather James Fine Art, SG Capital Management. So if we can give them a round of applause. So some of you may remember way back in 2013, we did a different Wild Wonders exhibit, and it was called Wild Wonders of Europe. Similarly breathtaking, beautiful photography with a similar mission that is meant to get you, the audience, viewers of these amazing photos, to think about places where wildlife exists, but that you might not really expect it or you might not know very much about. So these are educational initiatives as well as beautiful, wonderful things to look at. We did Wild Wonders of Europe in 2015, and it was in concert with the 10th World Wilderness Congress, sponsored by the Wild Foundation, and Vance Martin from Wild is here. So if you have any questions about the next World Wilderness Congress, which is Wild 11, is coming up in India in like 2 months, a month and a half.
6 weeks.
6 weeks, very quickly. And so we began this journey of Wild Wonders of China in conjunction with Wild 11 as well. So there's some really nice connections there that Vance will be happy to talk to you about. But without further ado, I'm going to briefly introduce our two photographers who are here all the way from Sweden. We're very happy to have them here. We've got Stefan Wistrand, who is a National Geographic Explorer and frequent jury member of several major photography competitions, including Wildlife Photography of the Year, World Press Photo, and the Humanity Photo Award. Stefan's authored 18 books and is a co-founder of Wild Wonders of Europe, Rewilding Europe, and the Swedish Ecotourism Association, as well as the Swedish National Carnivore Center. Magnus Lundgren is also an award-winning photographer, author, and juror. He is a true ocean lover. He has 6,000 dives under his belt and is regarded as one of the world's top underwater photographers. And we got a little training today, and I know that we probably haven't had an underwater photography show in a decade. So this is really interesting, and Magnus' work is phenomenal, as is Stefan's in the exhibit. Magnus leads expeditions into wild marine areas around the world and is the co-founder of Wild Wonders of Europe, Wild Wonders of China, and the Wild Wonders Foundation. So they're going to come up and give us some presentations. At the end of their talk, I invite you to join our reception out in Sullivan Hall, where they will be hanging around. They'll also be back in the exhibit, and so I ask that you save your questions for that point. But here, with that said, they're going to both come up and say a few words, and then each do individual presentations as we go through. So thanks again for coming, and let's welcome our photographers.
So let's see. Do you hear my voice? The back benches there. Good. Thanks. If by some chance you would not hear us anymore, please let us know. So hello everybody, and first of all, thanks so much to the museum, to Adam, to the staff, and to the sponsors of our exhibition for inviting the exhibition here, and then also for inviting us here. Now it's almost 8 years ago since I was here last time presenting the Wild Wonders in Europe, and now we are here very proud and happy to present Wild Wonders of China to you guys.
Yeah, so we will start with, my name is Magnus, and I'm also as honored as Stefan to be here. And we will start a little slideshow, it's roughly 4 to 5 minutes. And then Stefan will talk, and then I will finish off at the end. Okay? So.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm Staffan Wildstrand, and I'm a photographer since 30 years, and this is what I do, this is what I love, and this is what I want to be doing because I think it matters. Showing people the beauty of nature, hopefully engaging with the people's feelings and emotions, because if we don't love nature, it's doomed. And the more of us who love it, the better it will go for both for us, ourselves, and nature. And here's my dear friend and colleague, Magnus Lundgren, doing what he does best and what he's in love with, the underwater world. But he's, of course, also an excellent topside photographer. Okay, so China, wildlife and wild places in China. Most people that I talk to first time about these things, they say, China? Why China? Is there any nature at all? Isn't it just big cities and pollution and production and agriculture and fish farms, etc.? And to one extent, this is a true picture. This is a picture of the morning smog. Even smog is more beautiful in the morning in the city of Tianjin. And so it is a true picture of one place in China, and it's valid for a number of other sites. But this is also China, this is also a true picture, and reality has many faces. China is much more wild than any of us who started this project together had imagined. It's much wilder than Europe, and it's at least as wild as North America, with huge wild areas. And then there are huge city areas, of course, just like in all the other continents. How about the wildlife in China then? Most people would struggle to mention one more wild mammal species in China than the big black and white giant panda. Very emblematic, of course. If you think it's a bit unsharp, it's called art. In this case, it's what we call art by mistake. But I kind of liked it. I was actually focusing on the eyes, but when it came out like this, I kind of liked it. But China is the third country in the world when it comes to the number of wild mammal species. After Peru and Brazil, comes China. And that comes as a surprise to very many people. So during these few minutes here, I'll show you a number of wildlife species, mammal species from China. This is, of course, the red panda, which is not really a panda at all, it's just by name. It's more related to the raccoon, which you might see. And animals like the Harry David's deer. Now, this deer is now running in freedom in the Yangtze Valley, but that was not always the case. For 300 years, it was an extinct species in the wild, and it only survived in the emperor's deer garden. Luckily, a British lord came by and bought a few of them and brought them to England. And a few weeks later, there was a revolution, and the emperor's deer garden was taken by the troops, and they made barbecue of all the remaining deers. So then suddenly it was extinct from China. And then it came back 80 years later, and now there are about 3,500 of them living in the free. And there's also a whole bunch of bird species. Well, this is maybe the most emblematic of all China's bird species, the golden pheasant. This is, I believe, the reason why the Chinese flag is yellow and red. These were the colors of the emperor and the empire, and this bird existed at the core, in the core area of the Chinese empire forever. So we decided to make a long-term commitment to show the amazing Chinese natural heritage to the world. To the Chinese and to the world, because the world very outside China knows very little about Chinese wildlife and biodiversity, but also knows very little about the progress that has been made within nature conservation in China. And also in China, people are very little knowledgeable about what they actually have pretty much outside their doors. It started off with this. The Wild Wonders of Europe exhibition, pretty much the same that we showed here at the museum at that time. It went on a tour in China to six big cities, and we met people there. This is the poster from that exhibition. And we met people there, good, very committed conservationists, outdoors people, photographers, and they said, well, why don't we work together and do something similar in China? And that kind of took root with us, and we decided to try to do the Wild Wonders of China project. And I'll now show you a few more of the pictures from that. This is from the Yunnan province, which I made a red line around, and the Shangri-La area in the northern, northwestern part of Yunnan, right at the Himalayan foothills. And these are foothills, they're not hardcore mountains yet. A very wild place called the Mei Li Snow Mountain. That was actually the same mountain that was also on the picture a bit earlier with a cloud on top. It's a really wild area. It's protected in a system of national parks and nature reserves, and it's part of a big UNESCO biosphere reserve and World Heritage Site, that's the name. Wild forests and these incredible monkeys. These are the most high altitude living monkeys in the world. So they spend a lot of their time in snow and winter, and they eat mainly lichens from the trees. And these are big monkeys, you know, sitting on the ground, they'll be that size. So it's not the kind of you have in your lap or on your shoulder. With huge canine teeth that are for them to protect themselves against their main enemies, like the tree leopard and the leopard. If the previous one was big boy, then this one is the little boy. training the swing. Now, China is also the country of pheasants. It has 27 species of pheasants, many of them endemic. And if you hear this word endemic, we will mention it, both me and Magnus, a number of times. That means a species that's very restricted to a certain geographic area. So this one is, well, this species is not endemic. This is a blood pheasant. It's also in the other Himalayan countries. Many of the species are endemic, and either only to China or to the even to certain regions in China, or even in some cases just one mountain, and it's just only there in the whole world. And this is a white-eared pheasant. This is a bird size of a turkey, and was previously persecuted or at least killed to eat. Now they are increasing greatly in numbers, and they have been reintroduced to many areas where they were lost from. So we want to celebrate. I think one of the problems with nature conservation communication is that we talk about problems, 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 and problems. And it's a too strong focus on problems. So in our projects, both the European one and the Chinese one, we try to focus on celebrating what is here. Talking about the half full glass rather than the half empty glass, and to find whatever conservation success stories there are around. I will take you to one of those in Shanxi, in a place called Foping. And that's where another snub-nosed monkey lives. And this is the golden snub-nosed monkey. Also a Chinese endemic, exists only in central parts of China. And it's a very important animal when it comes to the mythology and traditions and art in China. It's, if you've heard about the story of the Monkey King, that's a golden monkey. And it's used in Tibetan art, and it's used in Buddhist art with a lot of symbolism in it. And when you see their hands, you realize they're not that far away from us. And they also have pretty decent canine teeth. And they also have the same two adversaries, the tree leopard and the leopard, plus a few others. Yeah, they do a lot of showing of teeth. Now, this is not pure aggression, and it's not directed to me, luckily. This is one of the big boys, and there was another big boy coming by, a bit too close to this guy's herd of females, so he had to show his teeth a bit just to show who was in charge. Yeah. And if anyone wonders why Kung Fu comes from China, this is where they learned it from. So it's a conservation success story, the golden monkey. It's coming back greatly in numbers, and which is really good news, and spreading out to parts where they have been gone from for ages. This bird might not look that much for the world, but it's a crested ibis, and it was considered extinct for 20 years. It's the national bird of Japan. It's in Latin, its name is Nipponia nippon. I mean, it doesn't get more Japanese than that. But the Japanese managed to let it go extinct in their country, and then it went extinct in the whole world, people believed. But luckily, there were still a little group left. So six birds were left in the world, found by a rice farmer who told the authorities that this was a strange bird. What is that? And now they've done, through nature conservation decisions, through a lot of banning of pesticides and a lot of changing of agricultural methods and breeding, captive breeding. Now they let them out again, and now there's like 3,500 of these ibis flying free out there. And they are multiplying and living a good life, it seems. Okay, so we move up to the northwest corner, and this is a dry, in the winter very cold, and in the summer very hot part of China called Xinjiang. So this is desert and semi-desert to a great extent. Here survives the last individuals of the wild horse, the last remaining purely wild, or almost purely wild horse. It's called the Przewalski's horse. It used to live from Spain in the west all the way to China in the east. And then we humans managed managed to kill pretty much every single one of them, but I think there were 7 left at one point in time, all of them in zoos, in the Prague Zoo, for example. And then again, captive breeding, reintroductions, nature conservation areas, protected areas, and then suddenly here we are with now I think there are about 1,000 strong in China, and there are similar numbers in Mongolia. This is also the country and the lands of the Bactrian camel, the two-humped camel. Now, this very individual on the picture is probably a feral camel, but sometimes it's really difficult to see. So that means a domesticated camel who has been let out and runs free and lives a free life until the owners or somebody who thinks they are the owners, they take care of it and use it for something. But the wild Bactrian camel is a critically endangered species, and there's less than 1,000 of them still remaining. The Siberian ibex is a very sought after hunting trophy, and hence disappeared over large areas where it used to be. But now again, they're coming back. China did a very radical decision 10 years ago, in 2009, they actually banned hunting in the whole country. And meat coming from Sweden, and you guys here, the hunting culture is pretty strong, and the whole idea of banning hunting in the whole country would be super difficult to understand. But in China, with so many people, and if the hunting was continuing the way it had been doing, free for all, then it would have been a total disaster. It was a total disaster, or almost total disaster, but now things are coming back. Yeah, so we focus on the positive message, celebrating joy and hope, inspiration, the light at the end of the tunnel, we hope. So we move to Qinghai, which is a part of the Tibetan High Plateau. It is Tibet, but it's not the province of Tibet. But it's just as much Tibet as inside the Tibetan province. The Tibetan High Plateau is all that brown stuff in the middle. And the High Plateau is about 4,000 meters high. And what would that be in feet? 12,000 feet? So then you think, okay, High Plateau with a lot of high mountains, and the high mountains are 4,000. No, that's wrong. The bottom of the valley is at 4,000 meters. So here we go. This is at 4,000 meters altitude where I'm standing, and then the mountains around are another 2,500 meters high. And by the way, that's the gate to the nature reserve. And I think in China they have pretty cool gates to the nature reserve. There's like no doubt when you're inside or when you're outside or when you're entering. This is, by the way, one of the two biggest nature reserves in the world. The second one is neighboring in the same area. So it's just two different provinces, but it's pretty much one big area, the Kirkichibi or Changtan. Now the main actor up in this high plateau is this guy, the pika. You have pikas in North America too, in Alaska and in the Rockies at some places. And in China, there's like almost 15 species of them inhabiting different ecosystems within the whole region. They are the main driver of the ecosystem. They eat enormous amounts of grass. Not that each one of them can eat so enormously much, but there's just enormously many of them. We're talking about millions and millions and millions. And the whole countryside is pockmarked with their nests or their caves. And they are then the food base. They keep the grass short, which is also good for all the other grazing animals around. And then they provide the food for a bunch of predators, like the sacred falcon. This is the Tibetan race of the sacred falcon. I bet in a few years' time it will be considered a separate species. It looks like a mix of a Lanner falcon and a sacred falcon. And the palace's cat, of course. And these cats, they live inside the colonies of pikas. So they pretty much live in the fridge. So they don't, fridge in two dimensions because it's pretty cold up here at this level. It's either cold or it's very cold. In the winter it could easily be 40 degrees centigrade minus, whatever that would be in Fahrenheit. Something twice as cold as your average freezer. But also in the summer it's pretty cold, I guess. So it's a pain to be at the bottom of the food chain, I guess, for the pikers, but we're happy for their performance. Another wonderful species up here is, again, endemic species, the Tibetan antelope. I don't know if you've ever come across a wool material called chatouche. It's probably the most expensive wool you could ever get. It was traded along the Silk Road in its times, and it's very cherished in Iran, for example. I think chatouche is a Persian-Afghan word from the beginning. This antelope was once in its millions and millions and millions moving around like in the Serengeti in a circle depending on the time of the year. And then they started harvesting the chatouche, but since it's a wild animal, you can't just herd it and cut the fur, so you just shot the animal and then took the fur. But now they're coming back in great numbers again, thanks to that hunting, the total hunting ban. And it was not only a hunting ban, by the way, it was also all rifles were called in, so nobody could have a rifle. That's again alien thought in our country, and I guess in yours as well. But in China it happened. So suddenly without guns, then a lot of wildlife survives. This is the Tibetan gazelle, another endemic species for the high plateau. And of course the biggest grazer of them all, the wild yak, 800, 900, 1,000 kilos. Heavy animal. And the endangered Przewalski's gazelle. There were only 200 of them left, but now there are 2,000, so that's again a good development. And the wild donkey, the Tibetan wild donkey, the Kiang. And they're all eaten by this guy, of course. The wolves, I've never seen so many wolves in my life as up in the Tibetan highlands. One of the days I was there in October and we saw a group of seven wolves on a daily basis. They were not super shy, they kept a little 50-100 meters of a distance and that was it. Several species of sheep, and this is the blue sheep, inhabit the plateau, and the specialist carnivore taking care of those blue sheep is this guy, the snow leopard. The ghost of the Himalayas. China has 60 or 70% of the world population of snow leopards. Anyway, so we're doing about 100 photo missions and we've done more than 30 so far, so we're not done with this project as of yet. There's still a lot to do, but what you're seeing now and what you see in the exhibition is a first taste of the wild wonders of China. We work together with many Chinese photographers and a couple of international top photographers as well. And they are rapidly becoming more of them, and they are becoming much better at what they're doing. And it's a joy to work with those guys. They're so enthusiastic and so good field people. The guy on the right, for example, he is the hero, the conservation hero behind saving the crested ibis, and that's what the flag that he's holding is about. Okay, so we're working on using all means of communication. First we've tried to gather a picture material that's big enough to say something and to show something, and then our ambition is to reach about 2 billion people with this communication. And after tonight, there's a hundred less to go. Here I'm interviewed by the local TV. And it didn't seem that much, but it happened to be Sichuan local TV. Yeah, that reaches 100 million people. So then we could check off 100 million. take care of what we love, but the question is, how can we expect people to love something that they've never seen, that they've never heard about, that they have no clue about that it exists? So our mission is also to put this image-based communication out there in the streets. This is in Beijing, the most famous shopping street in Beijing, and we reached about 1 million people here in a week. Or with this story from in China's biggest photographic magazine, with 50 million readers. Okay, quick move to the land of the Pear David's deer, where they have been reintroduced. It's an amazing accomplishment of nature conservation, although the cattle eagle might not find it completely enjoyable. And this is what the big male looks like when he decorates himself in wild pumpkins and a lot of other grass and stuff, just to see, for the females to see that he is the guy. And the beetles are pretty big over there. That kind of rhinoceros beetle. And a quick touchdown in Yunnan again, in the southwest corner of Yunnan, on the border of Burma. This is then a rainforest area, and tropical rainforest and subtropical rainforest. And then we find, for example, the Gaoli Gongshan tree frog, which exists only in that little mountain chain in the whole world. But there, it's very common. And the big, great hornbill, one of the biggest flying birds in Asia. The yellow-naped woodpeckers. And the red-billed blue magpie. And then showing those birds has become the job income, the main income for a lot of people of this tribe, the Lisu people. They have been hunting these birds since the Stone Age, and they know where to find them, and now there are people like us and hundreds of thousands of Chinese who would be happy to see these birds and to photograph them. And so they make money, they make much, much more money by showing live birds in wild situation rather than the dead ones. Birds like the golden pheasant, the silver pheasant, the grey peacock pheasant, and this pheasant that you might have seen before somewhere. But this is the original rooster, the red jungle fowl, the origin of every chicken in the whole world. Probably the world's most successful bird species, if you count it that way. One of the things I bet you don't know that much about is, because most people don't, and the Chinese also, even many Chinese don't, is that China was first in the world with nature conservation. 2,000 years ago. So even if Yellowstone was the first national park in the world, and that has then spread all over the world, and that's something for the United States to be super proud of, and all conservationists to be proud of. But the Chinese, they did this 2,000 years ago. That was pretty much 1,100 years before anyone else tried. But they didn't call it national parks. It was a Taoist, this guy, he's a monk, Taoist monk. So they did it under Taoist super influence. But some of those parks they created, they were 20,000 square kilometers big. So that's really, really huge. And there was no hunting, no fishing, and no logging in those parks. Very few national parks today have all those three elements when you look at in the world. This is one of them. Again, quite impressive entrance to the national park, the Beiyue Hengshan Mountains. Okay, I'll end up with some pictures from Inner Mongolia. And now we're in the steppe region, the big grasslands, where people have sheep, mainly. And they're herding them not only from horseback nowadays, but also from motorbikes and quad bikes, with mobile phones and solar reflectors and modern world reaching far, far out in the bush. And here, up here, these cranes breed, the white-naked crane. It's one of the rarest birds in the world. There's less than 1,000 individuals left, they think. critically endangered species. China has 9 species of cranes, and most other places we have much less. So with this picture I'd like to finish off, and I'd just like to ask you to, if you want to see more about pictures from our project also in the years to come, please follow us on Instagram and Facebook. We have these Project Wild Wonders of China and the Wild Wonders of Taiwan, and we have a website called wildwondersofchina.com. So thank you very much, and now I'd like to give the word to Magnus here.
Oh. Very short, I'm Magnus Langren, I'm a native photographer, and me and Staff have been working together for a long time in the European project and now in the Chinese project. I do a lot of topside nature photography, but my deepest passion is actually going underwater. So I'll just show you here that when I go underwater, you see basically the equipment I use is a regular camera, or a very nice camera. You put that camera inside a watertight housing. So the main objective by having a thing looking like that is just keeping that regular camera dry when I'm underwater. But you can also see I have some extra light with me, and that is also because I want to add I want to show the true colors that the animals have underwater, and because the light is very low underwater, I use crystals. Today I'm going to talk a little bit about Skywalk gibbons, one of the yellow, evergreen stories, and then also I'm going to talk about the Chinese ocean species, and a little bit about the great vertical migration, which is one thing that is supporting the Earth a lot, and I started to photograph inside that type of happening. And also a little bit about urban wildlife, because I did a mission in Hong Kong, shooting urban wildlife underwater. That is there. So, this is the three stops I'm going to do. So I start with the Chinese skywalkers, which is a gibbon species that I'm going to show you when I was shooting the gibbons in Yunnan, which is very far south, close to Burma border. And this is a typical situation where we're shooting. It's out in the tropical rainforest, but it's quite high, so it's like an evergreen situation. And it's a bit hot, but still at altitude, but it's very, very steep. So running around, just in front of us here is maybe 100 meters straight down. And so we're running around there and trying to photograph type of primate that is very moving very fast in the canopy. This is what is called the Skywalker Hulok gibbon. And it was first described in 2017. When we did the talk before, I was saying 2019, but it's actually 2017. So it's a very new species that they found in China, and a quite large primate. And that is very exciting, I think. There is still inside the jungle undiscovered species. This is you can see the typical eyebrows of the skywalker gibbon, and it's very distinctive way how to differ from the other species. And this is the male, which is dark. The name skywalker gibbon was actually given by the Chinese scientist that was a Star Wars fan. the name, as you can see here in Latin, is Hulok Tianjin, and that means heaven movement, and that's become Skywalker. And that name is picked up from an ancient book, that statement or that way of saying the word. So it's actually Skywalker both in Chinese and in English. That is pretty cool. Here you can see two of them. They are very difficult because when you walk in, when you actually photograph with long lenses on a very steep mountain, it's basically they are very high up in the canopy. But when you actually get in them in a tree that is a little bit lower, you can shoot them like this. And here you can see the female sitting behind, she's brown. And I find the female is much more shy.
And then the males in front here. They're eating leaves and fruits. And normally you find this type of primates about 2,000 meters. You have to convert that yourself, otherwise I make a fool out of myself. So that was the discovery of the skywalking gibbon. This is another one that the skywalking gibbon that I just showed you is in a very defined area. It's an endemic species, like Staffan said, and it's Gardegong Mountains. Now I moved on to something called Wuliang Mountains, and there is the black crested gibbon. And there are only 1,300 left in the wild. And there's like four different pockets of them. And one of them is on the Wuliang Mountain, and that's the subspecies that is living there. Here you see the male is singing. So in the morning they sing between 10 minutes and 30 minutes, half an hour. And it's a way for us to locate where the animals are. And basically there's been some discussions about why they do it, but it's a way to bond the family, but it's also a way to show other families that we their territory. And when they sing, it's absolutely magnificent. You cannot imagine what it sounds like when a gibbon sings. So I don't have the sound with me, but if you have the chance to go in and listen to gibbon singing, it is very, very special.
Part of the Chinese natural heritage.
found a place in Taiwan. There is a lot of green turtles swimming around. And it's a very endangered species, and very few of them, they have a hard time to survive in the world. They are the biggest turtle that has a hard shell, and they can weigh up to 400 kilos. I think that's around 800 pounds, roughly. And so this is a giant turtle, and they are true herbivores, so they are vegetarians, eating only grass. That's the only turtle that only eat vegetables. Many people think that turtles can go very, very old, but basically a green turtle, the maximum age is believed to be 8 years. Here you can see a little bit of the scale, we have the diagram, my fellow photographer on the back, and the turtle is eating. And they go up and down breathing air, of course, so when they're relaxed, they go up maybe every 5 or 10 minutes to breathe. It's a portrait. There's a story I told before when we were doing the round inside the museum, is that they found on one island in Australia that the global warming has made the sand a little bit warmer every year. So they decided to check the status of how many males and females were born, because the temperature in the sand is deciding if it's going to be males or females. So they put the eggs, if it's a certain temperature, it will become females, a certain temperature will become males when they hatch. During that period when they're in the sand. And they found out in that island in Australia, 99% of the born turtles there were female. So meaning that global warming is actually affecting reptiles in a certain way, and that could be a big problem for the population around that area. Those guys could be very busy, I guess. Okay, it's considered that 91% of the marine species is not yet discovered. That's a very thrilling number for me. Almost 80% of the ocean is unexplored. So when I was in Taiwan, I found this is a baby seahorse. This is the smallest seahorses in the world. You can see the seahorse is sitting inside a sea fan. So this is a detail shot. So maybe the seahorse that is sitting there, can you see it? Yes or no?
Yes.
The eye, the mouth, it's got the body, and it curves around. And it's imitating the sea fan, it's a coral, perfectly. And it was actually discovered in 1969 when they were doing research on sea fans. And they were actually on the table in the laboratory, and they found small seahorses. And that was the guy, his name was Barney Bounce, and that's why the seahorse is called Barney Bounce seahorse. This is 13 millimeter long, maybe 1 centimeter. A little bit longer. And that started, everybody fell in love with this pygmy seahorse, it's so cute. They started research, here's another close-up. And now they found 7 species. The last one was discovered 2018 in Japan. So there is several of them more to be discovered, I'm sure. But because they're so small and they don't move around, they have not been noticed. Here's another one. This one, I knew that it could be in a certain area. And this one is called Coleman's pygmy seahorse. And that was described in 2003. And you can see this, the algae is where it's living. When those algae turn, when they die, they become white. And you can see that the seahorse is white. And when it turns here, you can see that it looks exactly like a dead leaf on that in that habitat. So this one is 60 millimeters long. And when I look at in the books, it's not supposed to be in Taiwan. This species is described as only being on a certain island in Australia. So there's so much, so little we know about the ocean, and I'm just swimming around it for a short period of time. So you can imagine. This is another cool critter I found in Taiwan. This is called a can-can crab. And if you look closely, it has one small anemone in each claw. And that anemone has stinging arms. So it uses for defense. If you come close, it pops with the anemone like this. And it walks around with those anemones in its claws the whole life. So it's the can-can crab or the fox crab. It's also quite small. And sometimes when it feels a little bit threatened, it starts to dance like this. Here's another one, it's called the mantis shrimp. This, the mantis shrimp, it has, we have three receptors for different colors in our eyes. They are 12. And the scientists say that we don't know exactly what this animal sees. Maybe it sees a lot of different things that we don't see when it comes to bioluminescence, we were talking about that before. So, here you can also see that, oh, thank you. Cheers. It also has the fastest claw in the ocean. I have to point it out. On this particular mantis shrimp, the claw is shaped like a club, and there's a second one there. And that club can hit with the same speed and force as a bullet from a gun. And they were actually captured because here you see his skin is one of his eyes, one of the arms there. But they captured them and put them in aquariums, and they could actually bang the window of the aquarium and get out. So there's so much force. And I had one that actually was going from the port on my dome on my camera, so it was a bit scary. That's the peacock mantis shrimp. Very dynamic species. Here we have another one. This is the leaf scorpion fish that likes to sit around a point where you can see very well and where there's glass fish swimming around because it's eating the glass fish. And to lure to just trick the glass fish, it's swaying like a leaf, like this, when the ocean is moving. So it looks like some weed or some dead. And then you can see here, he's getting he's aiming for that fish now. And they have like a mouth, and it's opening the mouth, it's basically like you're pulling out a drawer in a furniture, because it creates a suction, and then the fish is sucked in. Here's another one, it's called the rinoki. This is kind of difficult to see what it is. It's a holding fish. Here's the eyes, here's the mouth, here's the pectoral fins, that's transparent. And this is an ambush, also a scorpion fish, lazy scorpion fish. And when the divers find them in Taiwan, they don't tell anyone where it is because it's so treasured for the aquarium industry. So if they tell anyone, it will just disappear from there. So for some of those most exotic fish, the aquarium trade is quite a hassle for them. And this one was for underwater photographers. This is like the holy grail of the scorpion fishes. Another one that we found in Taiwan is this is a big octopus mother that's actually taking care of her eggs. So she's finding a spot where to put the eggs, and the eggs is on the top, and she's just blowing water to put oxygen on the eggs, and she stays there until she dies. She will not leave, and she will defend them until she dies. And basically, when the children or the small octopus hatch. Her life is over. So many of the cephalopods, or the octopuses and squids, they'll have short lifespans, maybe 1 or 2 years. So usually when they spawn, they also die. This is a speed shot, so when I'm actually twisting the camera when I'm shooting, and that's called a burfish, or the porcupine fish, is sitting inside a big sponge, and I create some blurry motion around it, and they actually look like this. Have you seen ET? So these guys are really cool because they have a toxic skin and they can just inflate themselves until like a football, and then the spikes are sticking straight out. And it's they are toxic and it's very difficult to eat. So it's a defense mechanism. They're poor swimmers, so they swim around like a box basically, like this. It's another strategy along the coral reef in Taiwan is that some of the fish, they keep the eggs in the mouth. So it's a difficult shot because they only open the mouth a little bit. And then until the young ones hatch, they can keep them there. They say that in 2030, some scientists say that 50% of the coral reefs will be dead. They will be gone. And it's a habitat, it's a very specialistic society where all the animals have a task to fill. It's basically like a big city, like Hong Kong. So, many nations now start to protect coral areas. It's important because there are so many species that is kept there. It's an important thing to do. So one way to do it is with what we call MPAs, or marine protected areas, where you don't take fish, you don't fish anymore. It doesn't have to be a national park. It's quite complicated to do, but still small marine protected areas. And there is so different to photograph because all the animals are so close. They understand that that we are not dangerous. And like I said before, it's always complicated to start to protect an area. But after a while, everybody loves it. The fishermen even loves it because they fish just outside and it's spilling out animals so they can catch even much more around there. It is a very good system to protect the ocean. This is also a marine protected area where this giant chevalier, one of the fastest fish on the reef, is hunting. They can weigh up to maybe 40, 50 kilos. It's a huge fish, and it's very much a feared hunter. So ocean protection is going from, it used to be like 1% of the ocean is protected. Today it's around 7% of the oceans. The goal was to have 10% in 2020. I think that it's a very cheap way to do nature conservation is to protect ocean, because it doesn't cost that much to just block areas, and you don't have to manage them as much as topside areas. It's the same. Animals are very close. So in China, they actually just took a decision of banning non-degradable bags and also straws. It said, Stefan, I checked it out, at the end of 2020, this is going to be effective. And then that is for all the cities and towns. I want also to just say something about the vertical migration, because that's something I started to photograph, and that's basically when in the nighttime, all animals, a lot of animals, start to rise from the bottom up to the ocean surface. And it's the greatest migration on Earth that's happening every night. And there's very special animals coming up. This is like a snail that has some wings that can swim around. This is the squid, the tetanon squid. And they all, because in the daytime, the zooplankton, the phytoplankton, the vegetables, they grow on the surface. And then in the nighttime, the zooplankton come up to eat. And then the predators of the zooplankton follow. So it's a spectacular event. And it's happening every night in every ocean. Here's the big squid, the pelagic squid. You can see all the pigments on it. It changes colors very quickly. This is a flying fish. And it's just on the surface, you can see the river. This is a small cleaner shrimp that is actually living on the reef, but during the nighttime, when it's juvenile, it is roaming around and fishing out in the open ocean. This is a flatworm that is swimming basically like a magic carpet. So, what is the function of all this? Basically, the zooplankton pumps carbon into the deep. And where the carbon will remain for hundreds and thousands of years. The microscopic plants I was talking about, they're actually converting atmospheric carbon dioxide into organic matter that the other guys are eating. And it's also producing a lot of oxygen. Maybe 80% of the oxygen in the world is coming from marine plants. This is the squid. This is called bobtail squid, and that is the regular squid. Also, a lot of juvenile fish it's a very dangerous place to be on the reef. They actually live as kids out in the open ocean. A lot of animals have tentacles. They can even sting with them, or they can catch things with them. That's the long-arm octopus, and that is a hydroid, that's juvenile fish. Also, bigger fish that normally lives on the reef, when they are kids, they live out in the open ocean as transparent fish, and then they change to the wall. This was the first time they've seen the diamond squid. It's a very spectacular species, and that was when I was diving in Taiwan. It was the first time ever they saw that species there. So lastly, I will talk about Hong Kong, and I'm in Russia here. Hong Kong is a city that is very, very busy. This is a mud flat in Hong Kong. And I came here on a mission to shoot urban diversity on the water. And it was on a National Geographic Society grant. But people said the same million people living there. It's the main trading hub of China. It's a very busy harbor. They are the top seafood consumers in all Asia. They are accountable for 50% of the shark fin trade. And there's a lot of Chinese medicine. So good luck, Mike, because you will not find anything there. That's basically the message I got. But I found so much diversity, so close to the city center. This is the corals. And the corals live very close to the surface because it's not so clear water. And in the coral is actually an algae living, so that's able to survive. There's a clownfish, and it was guarding the small eggs next to the anemone. So there's a severe relationship between the clownfish and the anemone, of course. This is one of the most common fishes, but it's very, very easy to approach. The octopuses. All that is on the reef. But then we also decided here, you see, we are diving. It's a strong current, so we have to pull in the divers. But in the current areas, where the corals grow much deeper, because they have filter feed, they don't need the sun. So we found beautiful anemones. Here's a rockfish sitting inside the soft coral. This is a hawkfish. This is a funny fish. This is called a frogfish. It's actually walking around on the ground, and it has a fishing rod. So it can lure fish to come just in front of the mouth, and then it's all here. It's walking around. They're not swimming. It's very diverse. A lot of nudibranchs, which is basically, it's called the orchids of the sea, and divers love to watch them because they are so colorful and there are so many different species. There's like 3,000 species, and they say they find one new nudibranch every week in the world. One new species. Here's another one. Small, cute snails. Here's another one. So each time when you find them, you cannot really make up those patterns before. So what I found also in Hong Kong was there's a lot of nature conservation going on. They used the divers there to locate where they can find seahorses. And seahorses is one of those things that is used in traditional medicine. And they're very difficult spots, as you can see here. And I went out with the scientists and they measured them, of course, but then also they put a necklace around them. So after that, they have like a tag, and then the divers diving in the area can report back. And they can do a much bigger program and get much more data by using the divers in the area than they could do themselves. So that's a way to use, non-scientific divers to get a lot of data. And they're trying to save the seahorses in many areas because they are consumed and fished a lot. Here's another one. This is called the Chinese horseshoe crab that is also endangered. And there are some beaches there where you can find them. Here are some samples that they collected. And they made a program with all the kids in the school. So they raise one horseshoe crab each in each class. And then they go out to this special beach and they release this crab. And because they are consumed also in China, all these young people, they get a relation with the horseshoe crab, which is actually used for medicine for people as well. They have blue blood, there's a lot of stuff. They outlive the dinosaurs, these guys. This is a very special animal. And so now the young Hong Kongese people, they have a relation. They put a transponder in there as well. So they can actually go out and track them and find the same individual, and they can see how it's progressing. This is another species that I went out with the scientists, this is the white dolphin. There's a lot of ferries going between Macau and Hong Kong, and they're killing the dolphins. And they live there in a certain area where they're actually building the new airport. So there's a lot of efforts trying to save these white dolphins. We were out documenting them. There's too much boat traffic, too much things going on for them. My last example of what is going on in China when it comes to conservation and ocean is that one big problem is that there's so many Chinese people and it's so everybody loves seafood. So there's a lot of consumption.
So the Dilip campaign, because the NBA and basketball in China is huge. There was a problem now with Hong Kong, and there were some comments from the NBA, so they started to shut down the television, but then it came back. But NBA is huge in China, and they had a hero called Yao Ming, who was playing basketball, and they connected him to a program about shark feeding. Here's a shark from Bahamas that I showed with it. This is a great hammerhead shark. And basically, they went out and did a campaign, and then the slogan was when we stopped buying the soup, the killing will stop too. Mm-hmm. And China is one of the biggest. When you eat shark fin soup, when you want to honor somebody or have a nice dinner, and or when it comes to weddings and so on. But basically, this campaign was running maybe for 4 years, and the government banned all shark fin soups on the official bankers. The consumption is down by 50% on the biggest consumption market in the world by using a very famous guy and a very strong campaign. This meaning that we are in an era when it comes to social media, when it comes to communication. And that's one of those things that inspired me and stuff, and I think that we can actually make so much more difference today because we can reach so many people. So this is, I think, is a good example to end it. So Staffan, if you want to come up now, you can just say something about the foundation. So thank you very much.
We also run what we call the Wild Wonders Foundation, which has its objective to support visual-based nature communication. Because we think the emotional power of great photography is what is needed and what is missing in very many cases. You've seen some examples of some emotional visual communication, and it means it makes you feel something. It makes you, I think it's cute, beautiful, ugly, disgusting, all those emotions that we have. And the more of them you can tickle with photography, the more interest you get in why, how, when, where, what, etc. And then, so we started a foundation in order to fundraise, in order to support visual communications projects, not just the ones we do ourselves, but also those that others do. And we find that when in the nature conservation circles, that part of the conservation movement, so to say, has been under, the power of it has been underestimated. And we think that more stronger visual communication about nature and about nature conservation issues is needed, and it's reasonably cheap compared to buying land or to creating national parks, etc.
I think that, if I can say something, yeah, that when it comes to science needs to connect a lot with conservation, and conservation needs to connect a lot with communication. So all this has to be a joint effort, and I think that if you don't have the communication part, the spark is not there in the public, and this is so important. So we need to reach out when there is science, new science that is important that we know, when there is actually, like in China, when there's actually doing great things, but nobody knows about it. It's actually important that we feel that there is hope. So I think that's one of those things that we really want to support.
Yeah, well, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you all so much for coming. Let's give these guys another round of applause.